Okay, we're gonna get started because there are four very interesting people here, and it will take a while to get all these thoughts down. But thank God there is no common ground between these speakers today. They only share the stage and their appointment to be teaching at this school. Otherwise, I would have had to do more thinking about this introduction. They are young, they are energetic, they are obsessed with their own thing. And of what that is, we will find out probably later. The great thing, I think, about architecture to me is that it's within its own narrow boundaries or its own narrow focus. It offers so many different directions. Ideas and alignments. So I'm really excited to introduce and host these young architects to you. I don't quite understand their work or their specific articulation, but I understand their desire and their drive, and I want to know more of what makes them tick and why do they do what they do. This evening will hopefully not be a stretch, even though we will go over our allotment in time. It will be irrelevant to some and super exciting to others. I personally always cherish these moments where in a lecture I can get carried away into some of these crevices of some other mind, foreign to me first, but creative and challenging at the same time. And I can forget my own confused state of mind. It's like reading a good book in which one gets lost in. I can forget my emails, my Facebook shouts, my chores at home, at the office. I even forget the shopping list my wife gave me. And I even can forget sometimes why I'm here. But it's this space and the time which holds us together for an hour or so, diving into the minds of these young teachers. So grown up sometimes, who open their windows, and I see their raw sometimes and polished thoughts which swirl to the room. I see their dreams and special realities, only if it's a glimpse at sometimes. But to introduce these colleagues today, I feel like a travel agent selling you the prospect of a journey into the desires and creation of something which is maybe familiar but still foreign, cozy yet uncomfortable, beautiful and frightening, dreamlike and real at the same time. So let's not delay this departure any longer. We'll start in a reversed alphabetical order. And we start with, and we're gonna have running or sliding transition, so to speak. Guvenc Ozel, the other one in a heavy jacket here in this freezing room, is a member of the SUPRASTUDIO program at AUD, Ideas Division, and acts as a teacher and advisor. His firm, Ozel Office, is an interdisciplinary design practice, creating spaces, objects, and experience at the intersection of architecture, technology, and media, and ranges from experimental installations to residential buildings. Guvenc received his Bachelor of Art in Architecture, Sculpture, and Philosophy from Bennington College in Vermont. Is that? Yeah. And his Master's degree, Architecture degree from Yale University with multiple awards. He worked in the design offices of Raphael Vignoli, Jürgen Meyer, and Frank Gehry. His projects were exhibited in major museums and galleries like the Istanbul Museum of Modern Art and the Saatchi Gallery in New York. He formerly taught also at Yale University, at Woodbury University, and the University of Applied Arts in Vienna. His current research explores technologically enhanced environments, artificial intelligence, interactivity, cybernetics, environments where the user, environment, and performance merge in continuous feedback loops. He's currently leading a collaboration with UCLA Engineering Department to create robotically controlled construction techniques and novel 3D printing technologies with high performance material in the scale of habitable objects. As this part of this collaboration, his team was awarded at NASA 3D printed habitats challenges, which called for interdisciplinary teams to design a dwelling for the first mission to Mars. So off to Mars also.
Thank you for that introduction. I'm gonna talk a little bit about technology without ending up like this guy, hopefully. There's a lot of new gadgets that are entering our lives in the last year and a half. What I consider different about these particular gadgets is that they prioritize a certain sense of interface between the human body and the environment through sensor technologies. So in that regard, even though they are engaged in familiar issues like representation, vision, and actuation, I think they do it in very different ways. And this was the main topic of this recent paper that I wrote, and one of the subtitles in this paper was trans architecture. And what I meant by that is actually in a way directly in a way comparing it to recent philosophical notions like transhumanism and posthumanism, and thinking about a kind of technologically advanced enhanced version of architecture that negotiates between the environment and the human body without relying on the specific anthropomorphic qualities of the body. So in that regard, my current research interests focus on issues such as context awareness, such as cybernetic ecosystems of human sensors and robots, thinking about space as an extension of the human body rather than something that the human body actuates. Therefore, thinking about the convergence of interface design and architecture, no longer prioritizing the physical qualities of architecture, thinking about wearable technologies as a way to battle anthropocentrism, which basically allows us to detect certain intentionalities about human existence in space, but in a way enhancing them in a somewhat transhumanist way. Thinking about design systems as artificial intelligence and how we can think about self-generating design systems rather than focusing on the authorship of the architect as the sole designer of the built environment. And thinking about digital fabrication and how that, as a consequence of the issue that I just talked about, it could have the potential to become a generative fabrication form. And also, as a part of these physical manipulations, digital manipulations, and how they create an ecosystem with sensory logics, thinking about virtual reality as a synthesis of perception and representation, rather than a way to depict an existing form of reality. So, in that context, obviously you're familiar with some of the works that my students have done in the last few years, thinking about interactive technologies, thinking about generative design techniques, thinking about fabrication techniques as ecosystems rather than particular avenues of research, and thinking about how they actually create dialogues with each other while they are put into the same context simultaneously as a way to experience space. So this has actually originated as a part of my interest in media art way earlier when I was studying in undergrad and thinking about projections as a way to manipulate the environment. And I was always fascinated with their ability to create completely consuming spaces without actually building anything. So it might be a little bizarre for an architect to express an interest in environments that are not constructed physically, but I have always been, in a way, dissatisfied with the kind of material limitations of architectural design techniques and their consequences. Even issues such as motion has always, in a way, bothered me in the sense that it's always resorting a form of representation, and it is using the tools of the discipline to simulate rather than experience some of the pivotal qualities of motion in environments. So in that context, I started thinking about this notion of bypassing the human body to actuate motion in the environment. And in this project, Cerebral Hut, that I have done a few years ago, the intention is to actually create an environment that is physically in motion rather than representing motion. And it has an interiority and an exteriority, and then their qualities are dramatically different. But it allows the user to wear an EEG device, which is a sensory headset that measures your concentration levels through brainwaves. And it actually changes the environments according to certain patterns. As a kind of another example that I would call as trans-architecture, something that talks about the experience of space through sensory and computational logics, I was tapped by this electronic music artist based in London called Actress. And the thing that is interesting about Actress is that he samples very bizarre sounds. For example, he records the unheard sound of wood when it is wet and when it is bending, and then he samples that in his music. Another interesting thing that he has sampled is the sonic interpretations of electromagnetic waves as Voyager was passing through Saturn. So he's interested in these hidden qualities of sonic expression. So I thought that was a very interesting opportunity. So what I proposed for him as a part of his launch for his new album was to design a stage set and a pavilion, which would constantly assemble and reassemble itself based on a combination of different parameters, such as the motion of people around them, the real-time sonic composition, and obviously issues such as safety. So it was synthesizing different sets of presence as they relate to space, and then it in a way creates a kind of a construction that is constantly changing its form, even though it is happening in a very slow pace. So as this happens during the day, in the evening, it becomes a backdrop for a performance. The third project that I would like to show as a part of this intention is a proposal that I did for LACMA's Art and Technology program. And this is thinking about drones as a way to actuate a kind of a temporary enclosure that has the ability to as an initial step, take many iconic forms of architectural enclosure, such as a dome, a nave, and all sorts of different kinds of ceiling enclosures, which technically would happen through an array of drones that are holding a triangulated surface. And as a second iteration of that system, it would actually start to interact with a human presence as a way to synchronize and choreograph emotion that is happening in relationship with a performance. And for the museum, in a kind of a crystal fashion, I propose to have this almost formlessness be an advantage for this object and have it conceal and reveal different items in their collection. And in a way, it would be this kind of flying carpet that would scan through the entire collection and be able to interact with different parts of it. So thinking about architecture as an exclusively digital practice, I a couple years ago did this intervention called Project Source Code at the Venice Architecture Biennale, where I collected 3D digital models that I considered to be pivotal points in how we perceive the digital practice of architecture as a dominant mode of practice. So I asked also a few faculty members here, like Greg and Heather and Neil, to donate 3D models to me that I would upload into a server. And this server would launch, if you download the app in your phone, would launch these 3D models in a context-specific and context-aware environment, where you would go to the Venice Biennale, Architecture Biennale, with a treasure map, and you would point your phone into particular moments in the exhibition, and these digital models would show up as if they exist in the physical space, and they wouldn't show up anywhere else. So in a way, it was this notion of hiding and archiving digital information in a server somewhere in the world, and allowing it to exist as its own presence. And these two are the first 3D models and 3D scans that are ever created, and I managed to find the original files for them somewhere in the interwebs. And so the idea is to think about a kind of a visual perception and representation and the ability of 3D modeling tools to represent space without actually building space. So that leads me to the idea of building architecture. So I feel like building feels like either banging your head on something or head banging, depending on the amount of fun that you're having. So I want to show a few projects that, you know, some of them are happening, some of them are not happening. Projects live and die very quickly, and then they kind of get resurrected from their ashes again. This was a project that I have worked on a couple of years ago, which is a collection of five houses on the Aegean coast of Turkey. And the client was incredibly concerned with the idea of privacy. And so as a consequence of this intention, the project is organized radially to house a swimming pool in the courtyard that would only be used by the residents of each individual home. And as you see in the first image, the idea about the facade is to create a kind of a geometry that would also allow it to have a structural rigidity and a lot of thinness. So the research for the facade called for GFRC panels, but also re-questioning insulation, and we looked into materials such as Thinsulate in order to create a thermal insulation for this house so that it would be actually theoretically paper thin. Some of the shots from the model. And the plan organization is not only radial, but it is also happening at multiple different elevations. And a lot of built-in furniture. So the this project, like I said, kind of resurrected from his ashes, and I just am recently starting to work on this again, and hopefully it will go into construction sometime in the fall. The second project is an interiors for a San Francisco-based startup that is building this burger robot. Their idea is to create an automation system that would work with an app where you would walk into a fast food joint and it would make custom burgers for you without anybody making your burger. So it would be grounding the beef, the kind of beef you want, the amount of fat in it, the toppings, slicing the tomatoes, sauces, whatever you want. And then it would basically, at the end, plop out the burger for you. So they said, you know, we want you to design us a restaurant, but we want you to only design the furniture in it so that the organization of the furniture would create the space. And I said, that sounds great. And I asked why. They said, because we don't know where the restaurant is going to be, so we want to be able to move things in and out. So a lot of the large-scale items were limited by the size of a shipping container. So so what the design called for is to also think about some of the staples of a burger experience, such as the counter and the booth and multiple levels of seating. So on the upper left, you see a bar where you can sit into the bar and also have somebody facing you so that you can have a conversation while you're having your meal and also be able to scan the space while you're sitting at the bar. The furniture piece on the upper right is this kind of sectional shift in a table so that you can have two people sitting, two strangers, but they're not necessarily looking at each other. So these were some of the plays that happened that were based on the same idea of how to think about a typical diner experience. So this is the final design. You can barely see the burger robot that is supposed to be in the middle of that arch-like form so that people can see it from the outside, as well as they would be able to order a burger off hours so that they can pick it up from the window outside. This project is just I started working with. It's a 7,000 square meter hotel on the Aegean coast of Turkey. I'm going to scan through this very quickly. But the idea is that there's a multiple set of courtyards, but in order to erase this notion of this mega hotel, it has been subdivided into smaller sets of networks of courtyards. And so this is a really new project. And in this project, we wanted to also experiment with new modes of maybe communicating an architectural idea. So we threw the model into a gaming engine and try to see what we can get out of it with an Oculus Rift so that you can have this walkthrough. What's interesting about gaming engines is that you can obviously simulate physics, but you can also completely disregard them, and you can create jumps like this one, where you can jump up three stories high and look around and check out the view from the infinity pool. So the last project that I will talk about is the project that is the part of the collaboration with the engineering department. What I did last year was to approach the engineering department and say, hey, here's a set of different ideas. Would you guys be interested in collaborating with me? And then they said, well, about what? And I said, well, there's a competition that NASA is throwing for a 3D printed habitat in Mars. That would be the first mission to Mars. And they said, okay, let's do something together. So the idea was the program is calling for a four astronaut dwelling and lab space. And it had to be fabricated through some form of 3D printing. So unlike many of the other teams, instead of thinking about the Martian ash and soil as a way to, in a way, make concrete out of it, we propose this alternative idea of extracting the basalt and grinding it and heating it and fibering it to weave different kind of composite sheets, like in the form of sleeves or fabrics, and then they would later on be robotically manipulated with a custom resin that cures instantly. So that was interesting because one of the startups that the engineering department is sponsoring actually created such a resin. So we created this prototype that you see the video of on the lower left, where we're spooling a sleeve, and then it goes through a resin bath, and then it solidifies. So this is an ongoing project, a research project. As you see in the configuration, the Martian gravity is almost 1/3 of the gravity on Earth. And so the structure is lifted up in order to isolate the entry sequence of the astronauts into the structure so that a lot of the super fine dust wouldn't make its way all the way up to the equipment on the upper levels. So again, we threw this into Oculus Rift to see how you would experience this Martian environment. And there's going to be an exhibition at the A+D Museum that is opening in a month, I believe. And if you come to the opening of the exhibition, you can experience this through virtual reality. And it is a very bizarre experience because even though the graphics obviously do not match actual reality, the fact that there's such a coordination between your motion and your vision, even though what you're seeing is not the physical environment, is absolutely mind-boggling. And it really teleports you to a different kind of space. So at this point, you know, through this VR stuff, it's a lot of playing around. But I strongly believe that their possibilities are endless, and their ability to represent space would, in fact, at some point, I believe, would be sufficient enough to have them be perceived as a equally convincing form of reality as physical reality. So this is the end of my presentation. I'd like to thank also some existing and former students like Jingjian and Honor and Mert and Simi for helping out with some of these projects, and thank you all.
Presenter. We said 15 minutes, but we stretched it already a little bit. But Julia Koerner is an award-winning designer, works at the convergence of architecture, product, and fashion design. She specializes in additive manufacturing and robotic technology. Her work can be found in such diverse publications and institutions like the National Geographic magazine and the Venice Biennale. She hangs with the Paris Haute Couture and exhibits at the Frac Center in New Orleans, or in Orleans. Not New Orleans, sorry. Her designs are the embodiment of a beautiful organic aesthetic and are recognized today at the top level of these merging disciplines. Julia is also a founder of the JK Design GmbH, specializing in digital design for 3D printing. Her most recent collaboration involved 3D printed fashion pieces developed with Maison Léjage. Other works have included
work with Dutch designer Iris van Herpen for haute couture collections in Paris. And in 2015, just last year, Julia launched an entirely 3D printed ready-to-wear collection entitled Sporophyte. Julia was born some stone throws away from my own alpine town, the city of Salzburg in Austria. She received a master's degree with distinction at the University of Applied Arts in Vienna and the Architectural Association in London. She jet-sets between Los Angeles, Salzburg, and has previously practiced in London and New York. As a lecturer here at AUD, she teaches the postgraduate SUPRASTUDIO and several research seminars. She has held previous academic appointments at the University of Applied Arts in Vienna, at Lund University in Sweden, and she's part of the Architectural Association's visiting school in France and Jordan. Take it away, Julia.
Thank you, Mark, for this really great introduction. I think you already took over my lecture, so. Tonight I would like to talk about the three different, about my work in the three different disciplines, architecture, industrial design, and fashion design. And while these are all three very different disciplines from each other and distinctive, I feel that my work process allows me to bridge between these different fields and to actually collaborate with many great designers and fashion designers and architects. I want to go all the way back to the Angewandte, where I was studying with Greg Lynn for 4 years and have been always interested in the organic and the biological. And having studied with Greg and worked in London, and have done my second master at the AA, I actually, in 2012, Greg invited me to come here to UCLA and teach with him. But that wasn't actually my first time in Los Angeles. I was here before in 2010-11 when I did the Mack Schindler Scholarship, living in the Mackey apartments and studying the biodiversity of California in every little detail, traveling between national parks, studying the natural environment and artifacts, patterns, and I got sort of really interested in analyzing these structures further, and not only looking at the patterns as a visual and aesthetic point of view, but also understanding the mathematical logics and geometries they are based on. And so I traveled between all these national parks and photographed and mapped and scanned all these different systems. And I feel that's the basis of all my work, that I always keep on looking back into nature and how that can sort of inspire me and my work. So I studied bones, and I keep on doing this here at UCLA with the students, scanning and mapping natural artifacts and studying their base structures. So first I would like to talk about architecture and the research I have been doing starting at the Architectural Association in London with Marie Bolton-Stern and Kaisal Ravi, where we looked into cellular systems and their complexity of such as corals, sea stars, and so on. And we actually CT scanned those to see not only the outside surface of these, but also the interior spatial qualities, what they inherit. We sort of started to code these and investigate the mathematical logics of these space packing systems and see what the underlying relationships within the porosity is. But not only the gradients of porosity on a small scale was interesting to us, but also how these could, like the structural performance of these systems and how they can be integrated in facade systems. So we developed that research actually further, and this was the TexFab competition which we won, and this was a prototype which we plasma cut, robotically cut with Andreas Fresh, where we actually produced a facade prototype which was exhibited at the Acadia conference in 2014. And we also produced a robotic video showcasing this prototype, which was part of the requirements for the competition. Ongoing, taking this one step further, we got invited to actually design an exhibition, a 2x8 exhibition for the AIA here in Los Angeles. And this was an exhibition design which exhibited 32 of the best projects from all over California's universities. And it was an installation at the A+D Museum, which was all CNC cut expanded PVC, which didn't use any fasteners or glue, so it can all go flat pack and be shipped somewhere. And of course, the intricacy and the porosity change within this structure was sort of the next step of this. I also would like to talk a little bit about my work and the architectural dimension in the product design during my time when I worked with Ross Lovegrove in London, where we looked at how digital design processes can actually be applied on the development for real product designs. And we looked into multiple different fabrication techniques and technologies and how digital processes can enrich traditional techniques of producing such projects. So we collaborated on this Cosmic Leaf series for Artemide, a Milan-based design company, light design company. And we developed this light in multiple different scales. So there's like an injection molded light, and there's also a vacuum formed light. And we continued the research with another light design for the new nature light, as Ross calls it. And in this particular one, we looked into injection molding and how you can achieve a certain complexity with one and the same part, so all the entire light is made out of one piece, combined in multiple different ways to get this sort of continuation over the vertical scale of the light. So this brings me to the third part of this very short lecture, which is digitally crafted couture and the architectural dimension in the contemporary haute couture. So, as you saw in the previous sections, I got really excited about the product design scale and how these techniques can actually be achieved in a one-to-one scale. So how can you design within the computer and then rapidly prototype these out, but actually have a product on a one-to-one scale? So I started to look a lot into 3D printing and worked with Iris van Herpen, a Dutch fashion designer, on the hybrid holism collection for a 3D print, which was showcased in Paris in 2012 as part of her haute couture show. So when we started to collaborate on this piece, we actually used a mammoth stereolithography technique to realize that piece in two parts. The 3D prints actually took one week to realize, and the complexity and intricacy within the dress was expressed in a very geometrical understructure and more organic leaf-like structure on the top, inspired by Ernst Haeckel. So we looked into how we can actually use the raw material of this stereolithography, the resin and its honey-colored light appearance. Here you can see a digital file rendering. And we were also interested in how the symmetry reflects in multiple different directions. So here you can see a top and a bottom view of the piece. And the piece was exhibited in the Archilab exhibition in 2013 as part of many other architects being included in that exhibition. And it was showcased in many different editorials, such as this one. you can see with that piece, actually it was very hard material, so it didn't really move with the body, and it was very restricted purely because of the material it was 3D printed with. So we got really excited in 2013 to actually be able to work with Materialize using a new material, which was back then had no name, and it was a flexible material. So that was for the Voltage Haute Couture show, which was also in Paris in 2013. In that piece, we were actually looking into how the layering system can be structural, both and animating the body in a lace-like way. So how you can create certain transparencies over the body in certain areas, make it more dense where it needed to be more structural, and more lightweight and translucent in areas where it didn't need to be. So it was both a combination of an aesthetical point of view, but also as a material behavior. So I want to share this video with you where it explains a little bit and shows how the technique actually works. This material by now has a name, it's called TPU, and it actually comes in two colors, in white and in black. The black is dyed, so we continued working with that material in the third collaboration with Iris van Herpen in the biopiracy dress, where the show was again in Paris, but it was the first ready-to-wear show where we actually used the 3D printing technique. And it's, again, TPU material, however, it's coated in a dragon skin silicone to make it even more flexible and animate the body in a more organic way. This was a very complex 3D print because it consisted out of many different parts which were later on sewn together, so this wasn't actually printed in one piece. Due to the capacity of the flexible 3D printing material, which doesn't come yet in such a large scale. Both this dress and the hybrid holism dress are currently exhibited in the Museum of High Art in Atlanta, and is going to travel around Northern America for the next 3 years. So you can go and see it there. These are some digital renderings and close-up details of the structure. It was actually a Victoria's Secret model, Devin Winsor wearing it, and it was published in the National Geographic next to a lot of scientist articles and so on. So the collaborations with Iris van Herpen were really great in a way to work on haute couture pieces. However, my personal interest more and more goes into the ready-to-wear with the 3D printing. And so I collaborated with Marina Hermansid, a Berlin-based designer, on a piece which was showcased in Berlin last summer. And this is actually a ready-to-wear piece, which was also a collaboration with Materialize. However, it wasn't our main interest to push the technology in this case, but rather make a piece which is wearable. And so it was part of her ready-to-wear collection. And I also got the opportunity last year to work with Stratasys together and work with them on my own collection, which was the sporophyte collection. Again, I looked into 3D scanning, in this case for the balloon mushroom underside. So I called the jacket the humanium jacket, and I 3D scanned the mushrooms and translated the structure into a jacket. We did a big photo shooting session at the James Goldstein residence, and it was published in the Schön magazine. I collaborated with an Austrian photographer, Gerger, on this. And the feedback we got back was actually really interesting, because the material still isn't yet there to have these pieces really ready to wear. However, we are researching more and more how this can go into that direction. Same with the kelp jacket, which was inspired by seaweed understructure and this lace-like behavior of the seaweed. And this was printed in three different colors, so Stratasys actually has a technology which can combine different colors and different structural behaviors in the material. So you can have certain areas within the jacket which are more hard and certain areas which are more soft, depending on what kind of strength you apply on the certain areas. And this jacket was also being part of the Tallinn Architecture Biennale last year in Estonia, and it was really exciting to be exhibited next to all these architectural models, because it sort of shows that the technique and processes we use within architecture are sort of infiltrating a very new discipline fashion. So part of that sporophyte collection was also a necklace, which was showcased as well in that photo shoot, and this is actually going to be part of the silent auction here at AUD during the gala of the 50th anniversary. So I want to talk finally a little bit about that I have been always asked where this is going and sort of the future of 3D printing and the work and how it allows me to sort of explore 3D printing in a new way, which I believe that in architecture I wouldn't be able to yet explore it in that complexity and in scale. So I think that these collaborations actually of these very progressive fashion designers allowed me to look with them together and research how this can actually change an entire industry. And so I have been recently asked to work together with a Parisian embroidery house, which is actually belongs to Chanel. And they are really interested in the traditional techniques of hand craftsmanship and how that sort of combines with the new technology of 3D printing. And so I want to end with a comment of Karl Lagerfeld and what he has to say.
Fashion has to follow everything that's going on in the world. And I like the idea of the most iconic jacket of the 20th century, redone in a technique it was even not possible to imagine that one day such a thing could exist.
Thank you.
Thank you, Julia. Steven Christensen, also a mountain boy from outside of Salt Lake City, Utah, who also lived in Luleå, Sweden, San Francisco, Washington, D.C., and Cambridge, and Ann Arbor, where he taught at the University of Michigan from 2008 to 11. He received a Master in Architecture from Harvard's GSD in 2008, and he worked in the office of Preston Scott Cohen as part of his design team for the Tel Aviv Museum of Art prior to coming to LA. Stephen is actually my neighbor, or lives very close, and his background in psychology flavors his architectural desires. With the current interest in polyvalence, or the potential for design to engage a diverse audience by operating on multiple intellectual perceptual strata, He keeps me on my toes. Stephen's work has been published and his project have been selected for inclusion in several exhibitions. Most recently in the 2014-2015 Emerging Professional Exhibition at the National Headquarters of the AIA in Washington, D.C., and at exhibitions at the A+D Architecture and Design Museum in Los Angeles. At the 2015 LA Art Show, and in the forthcoming Athenaeum exhibition in Chicago and LA, Athens and Berlin, he will be present. Here is Stephen.
All right, thanks everyone. So this mini lecture feels a little bit like an introduction, even though most of us have already been introduced. So anyway, I'm Stephen. I graduated from the GSD in 2008 and have been teaching ever since, University of Michigan and then here. So in a sense, I'm kind of nearing the end of my second term in academia. And accordingly, it's an interesting time to reflect back upon the kinds of anxieties my class and I felt upon graduation, and how I define my interest apart from my education. First of all, as Mark mentioned, I came to architecture by way of psychology, and accordingly I'm interested in the way our work delivers content outside of our discipline. I'm still a fan of the disciplinary echo chamber and a total architecture geek, but ultimately I'm most interested in how we can contribute to cultural discussions that go beyond the boundaries of our field. Anyway, like many friends who graduated around 08, I had a sense that we were approaching a kind of end of an era, so to speak. It seemed in school that the most recent generation of junior faculty were hired due to their kind of prowess in digital technique. In school I was making these kinds of parametric projects, but started to feel that what I was working on was kind of the project, a project that belonged to my faculty and was interested in working on something different. In addition to that, we were in the midst of the economic collapse that had made our generation somewhat skeptical of large-scale, formerly exuberant wonder, instead adding fuel to the fire of or the rampant spread of industrial chic. And like many of my friends, I sort of returned to an interest in fundamentals. But lest such fundamentalism seem conservative or regressive, I should say that I have nothing against large-scale, formerly exuberant wonder. You know, I loved working for Scott on Tel Aviv. I was working on it as I was thinking these things through. But Sylvia and Jeff Kipnis were two other members of my GSD triad of influence. And they led me to think about ways architecture can be more covert in how it produces effects. So speaking of wonder, that was oddly the topic we were asked to write about during our first week in school. And it was a task I somewhat stubbornly considered anti-academic, but have since kind of come around to be interested in it. And this assignment was really focused on the kind of wonder that would characterize the seven wonders of the world, or the Gothic Cathedral, or perhaps the latest Maya design monument in Dubai. It's the first definition you'll find in most dictionaries, to be filled with admiration, amazement, or awe. But then there are the next two, to think or speculate curiously and to doubt. If the wonder of large-scale exuberance, or perhaps OMG in contemporary parlance, was deemed both inappropriate and out of reach. The second category perhaps is more interesting for me in that it permits both the radically unfamiliar as well as the slightly out of whack. With a nod to Umberto Eco, who passed away this Friday, I'd say WTF is perhaps the wonder of the open work, or the project that eschews a singular narrative in order to attract diverse interpretations. So speaking of which, let's look at some work. This slide shows tools and targets of the first projects I'll show you. And I'll start with an installation that I proposed for the A&D Museum last year, and one that later moved to the Timothy Yarger Gallery LA Art Show, where it was a special exhibit, and finally public storage on Sentinella. This is a project that twists the arm of indexical formalism in order to yield something visceral, sort of like getting Clement Greenberg to do a striptease. When I was invited to propose an installation that dealt with the topic of scale in Los Angeles, my thoughts turned immediately to the Eames' seminal Powers of Ten, it's hard not to, in which they use temporality in order to collapse a range of spatial scales into a single work while showing us the unfamiliar and exuberant qualities that can be found at the extremes. This was a group show, so a large site-specific installation was off the table. However, I was determined to produce an interior, and I began to envision something along the lines of a large phone booth or maybe organ accumulator. With a nod to the Eisenman-esque arbitrary and out of an affinity to geometric primitives, I began with a cube rotating 30, 60, 90, then began trimming away at the overlapping surfaces along their embedded planes of cleavage. The interior surface shows the fully trimmed stage, while the exterior is left at an intermediate step. And the excised geometry of the earliest stage is projected onto the final exterior as a series of topographical contours engraved in its surface. Traces of the project's formal genesis yield an excess of information, and the project strives not for legibility but hyperindexicality, a kind of transubstantiation from the descriptive to the visceral. So paradoxically, we wanted to use simple steps and a description of process in order to yield something unfamiliar and perhaps a little bit obstinate in its resistance to understanding. The bright and dark patterns produced from light striking the project's skin pay a subtle homage to op artists such as Bridget Riley or Victor Vasarely, and the ways in which they capitalize upon and frustrate our Gestalt perception of form. Their work prods at the difference between what we see and what we think we see, making us aware of psychological processes that typically occur subconsciously by demonstrating their susceptibility to error and deceit. So, inside this relatively diminutive monolith lies a kind of space multiplier. My initial proposal for the work included off-the-shelf LED screens on the interior, but I later asked my friend Mass Christensen, no relation, to collaborate on the work. He hand-built the custom LED screens that lined the interior and produced the visual content, which is an enlarged tracking shot of the exterior. And this washes across the three linked screens and the semi-reflective surfaces inside. And the resulting effect, I would say, is quite visceral. While some people find it hypnotizing, others find it quite literally destabilizing and feel a little bit sick or maybe fall over. So the next installation was part of a larger unsolicited show entitled Ruin Porn at the abandoned Federal Screw Industrial Complex in Michigan. So if anyone is from Michigan or is kind of aware, the topic of ruin porn is particularly charged for Michiganders who see the exported imagery of their decaying industrial heritage as exploitative and guilty of perpetuating a myth that excludes other narratives of resurgence and growth. We sought to question whether the shedding of fears regarding exploitation could yield empowerment and ownership, allowing the locals to capitalize on the enthusiasm that surrounds the post-industrial. The exhibition was the culmination of a research seminar I taught in France with two friends, Anya Sirota and Jean-Louis Farge, where we looked at the relationship between French attitudes toward ruin and individual liberty in the contemporary city. So the students exhibited their video work and produced installations throughout the complex, while at the core, we designed the project's centerfold, which was a mysterious magenta void that you entered through a kind of jury-rigged jetway. So this project's title, General Manifold, references both its geometry and its context. So topologically, it's similar to the way high-dimensional manifolds are represented by mathematicians in three dimensions, while It's cited in a factory where the hardware for automotive manifolds is produced. These also share a similar topology. So while my earlier installation work dealt with the conventions of perspective in drawing, this deals with conventions that are inherently digital. Instead of working with cones of vision, the form of this project is derived from the assembly of multiple view frustums that engage the historic walls of the existing space. So the view frustum is a primitive used to describe and organize the perspectival space of rendering, especially in live rendered environments, such as those of the first person shooter games that are often cited in ruinous landscapes such as these. So by reifying the perceived space of the frustum as a literal form, the project frustrates our autonomic perception of space. Through distortion and destabilization, it makes us aware of the psychological activity that usually takes place in the subconscious. Now, unfortunately, collapse back on the picture plane of PowerPoint. This effect is pretty much totally undone. So trust me. So in addition, the project disrupts the way we perceive space via sound. So each pyramid emits part of the project's six-channel soundscape, which we produced. And this layers machinic audio from the site's industrial past over readings of seminal ruin texts by Viollet-le-Duc, Ruskin, and Diderot. And these readings were performed by Brandy Moses, an urban explorer, radio host, feminist, and Playboy centerfold, who was interested in the project's challenge of traditional attitudes regarding exploitation and empowerment. So if the last two projects sought to provoke curiosity using the sensorial and unfamiliar, the next two work with the slightly off, or distortions of the familiar. So each of these projects extends from a broader interest of mine in the gestalt quality of various roofs and their underlying geometric primitives. So for the first, a thermal bath in Latvia, a project that we codenamed Bubble Bath in the office. I was interested in the role of the dome and its effect on behavior. The dome is an organizationally efficient form, reinforcing centrality and hierarchy, and it's perhaps architecture's most potent signifier of power. And now I'm the product of an emphatically anti-POMO education, in which Albert Speer was often invoked to remind us that any hint of classicism in our projects would render us morally equivalent to Hitler. Nonetheless, signification is one of architecture's most powerful tools in terms of psychological engagement, and accordingly, I'm interested in the territory between signification and abstraction. Now, the dome has a history in the tradition of the public bath as well, spanning several centuries, and I was also interested in its attendant effects. So accordingly, we wanted to work with the dome's basic primitive, the sphere, in order to produce a space that was non-hierarchical, decentralized, and rhizomatic, where the multiplication of a familiar form could yield spatial effects that were a little bit unfamiliar, labyrinthine, and immediate. And the last project I'll show is one that's almost through permitting. It tries to covertly smuggle some of the aforementioned interests into a real project that has to deal with program budget and a ridiculously constrained site. There might be other projects that would fit better into the theme, but it seemed appropriate to show you something I'm working on right now. So Emigration House comes from my mountain boy birthplace, Emigration Township. It's the canyon I grew up in outside of Salt Lake City. And its name comes from the location on the main overland route used by groups like the Donner Party, Mormon Pioneers, etc. My parents moved up there into a one-room cabin with an outhouse in the 50s and sort of lumped a new room onto it every few years after that, which is how I actually learned about hyperbolic paraboloids, because we had to kind of drywall between, you know, two planes that weren't straight. Anyway, Mountain Boy. Now there are nice houses up there too, and then this one will be on a hill that's about 6,100 feet above sea level. So it has, you know, great views of the unobstructed views of these two hills on one side, the city below, blah, blah, blah. So it's a big site, 7 acres. It's incredibly constrained by a patchwork of ordinances that could yield a lecture in itself. So the unrestricted building pad was about 5% of the site. After about a year-long fight with the Planning Commission, we have now this buildable area that is shown in number 5, this very, very strange little sliver of land. And the house sort of adapts to the sliver and the topography. The rectangular bar is kinked in plan and section to fit the site, align entry views to the peaks, and reach uphill to catch a straight shot view to the city below. But none of that really has anything to do with the lecture topic. But given my interest in rendering familiar forms slightly unfamiliar, I'm currently working with this idea that the contortions of the kinked bar could yield a set of transformations on the project's gable roof, while also working on ways in which the slight misalignment of lines within the area of the kink could yield forced perspectives or collapse the depth of certain elements into a single visual plane. So all the built work that I've managed to do on my own since graduating has thus far been interior furniture or installation based. So this is also my first opportunity to see what happens to these ideas once they rub up against the priorities of structural engineers, builders, and the like. While I find that my interests tend to play out best at scale or extremes of small installations or large public buildings, this has definitely been a worthwhile and interesting challenge to try and find opportunities within a project of this size, and especially one that has to deal with such a wide variety of other demanding constraints. So this is what we worked on this week. This has been good practice. This is a kind of model that's coming out of work with the structural engineer, and hopefully we will be starting digging soon. And I'm over my time, so I will leave the postscript out. Thank you.
Thank you, Stephen. Erin Besler is co-founder of Besler and Son with Ian Besler. They are currently working on a project about content management and material inventories. So they're planning to store other people's project and custom grades at the A&D Museum for 3 months. So Erin, I went onto your website, since I'm in need of these services, www.beslerandsons.com, but I've only found an error message. Maybe you can correct that. So, Erin Besler was born on a mountain in Chicago. She holds a Bachelor of Arts in Architecture from Yale University, a Master of Architecture with distinction from the Southern California Institute of Architecture. She is co-founder with Ian Besler of Besler and Sons, and they have many sons now working for them. And their work has been published in many publications, and they have many been finalists for the MoMA PS1 Young Architects Program, won the Architectural League of New York Young's Young Architects Prize, and were recently participant in the Architecture Biennials of Chicago, Shenzhen, and Hong Kong. They practice works across multiple sites of production through references to reuse things that they find interesting, and refit them into a slightly different framework. Sometimes those references are really clear in their work, and sometimes they're not.
So Erin, just clear us up a little bit.
So thanks very much, Mark. Thanks for coming tonight. So I wanted to talk about some of our most recent interests tonight and some ideas that are sort of super current in our work, but maybe not quite figured out, and also something that I haven't talked specifically about before. So I'd say these are issues or interests that are just starting to make their way into our projects, and they mostly surround things related to do-it-yourself culture, public participation, and also distinctions that are commonly drawn between professionals and amateurs. And I'm not quite sure where we sort of fit or where our place is in there. So a few of our recent projects have tried to put these things to work through mock-ups, software, and videos, but actually, so rather than showing our work tonight, what I wanted to do was talk about these ideas as the kind of subject of an essay that we're writing for Perspecta, that Ian and I are writing for Perspecta. So, there are a lot of maybe artifacts in the world of DIY, and online instructional videos and software tutorials are like a lot of those things. So they usually seem more likely to capture your attention or more instructive when their production quality is either super high or, as more often the case, is excruciatingly low. And maybe because they're more easily relatable and somehow narratively linear than the older sort of format of printed user manuals that came before them, it seems like online instructional videos and software tutorials have become a way for individuals to learn to navigate and use software and operating system interfaces, and to also find a meaningful form to insert themselves as both producers and consumers into the discourse of design interactions. So we've watched dozens, maybe even hundreds of online tutorial videos and collected our favorites in this YouTube playlist that I'm playing from right now. You can all go on to Erin Besler's YouTube and watch them. So these are the ones with, like, we found that ones with, like, the highest degree of viewership sit at either two poles. So on the one hand, there are videos that are produced for paid subscription services like lynda.com or for massive open online courses like the Khan Academy or Coursera. And all those videos have pretty seamless production, a kind of demonstrated professionalism or verified expertise, and a coherent instructional arc. And then on the other hand, we have almost the complete opposite, right? So videos like this one, where they have a sort of faulty or distracting production, no clear instructional arc, most have a number of pretty random digressions or completely unrelated heavy metal background music. So these are the online instructional videos we're most interested in, where for whatever reason someone who clearly has no discernible expertise with a given software or technique decides to make an instructional video and upload it onto YouTube. So the line that's commonly drawn between professional and amateur, actually, there are a number of definitions that set the professional in opposition to the amateur, and most of them are actually pretty reductive. So most of the time the opposition is established based on economics and usually some kind of certification of expertise. So basically, professionals are licensed in some way and paid for their work, but amateurs aren't. But I guess in this, we're interested in looking at the category of the online software tutorial for a lot of reasons, but mostly as a way to rethink the limits of that distinction because between amateur and professional, and its sort of inadequacy for other models of production, maybe even how, I don't know, we're operating right now. So the video tutorials that are uploaded on YouTube, all of them are, of course, screen captured in some way and shared on social media. They provide a kind of, or a sense of control over the scripted and maybe even routine digital processes that so many users negotiate on a daily basis. So in a sense, they turn the menu drop or the mouse click or the scroll or the hotkey shortcut into a set of performative gestures. And at the same time, this represents an increasingly important and often overlooked space for users to convey some kind of authority in the otherwise detached and impersonal expanse of the digital workspace. So the instructional video is a form of communication that's most often dependent on speaking, in this case not. And the digital record of screen captures, audio tracks, and webcam files, along with various platforms of playback and dissemination. So it's deeply entangled in the context of its capture, delivery, and repetition. And the format of online tutorial relies on a kind of familiarity or maybe even functional capacity of the performer or instructor and the audience.
So this all kind of revolves in a way around the difference between what we might call commentary, so when someone speaks over or around something, versus instruction, like speaking directly to something or some subject matter. And in the case of YouTube videos, they often make use of the kind of affordances of online video platforms. So the step-by-step order of selections, tools, clicks, and drags that can always be reiterated in a way through rewinding or skipping or skipping over boring preambles and clarifications. And if necessary, you can always request more details in the comments. So the earliest examples of these kinds of narrated amateur software tutorials on YouTube date back to around 2006. This was when the YouTube site was maybe, this one's really good too, only 2 years in existence. And it was becoming extremely popular right after it was acquired by Google. And today there are hundreds of different kinds of software programs that seem to gather a collection of user-made tutorial videos. But out of all these, the program that seems to stand out among all of the others is SketchUp, probably because it provides a pretty compelling and rich combination of qualities which seem to communicate a really amateurish, uncontrolled, and improvised tone to the work produced through the software and also by extension the tutorials that accompany that work. I think that's a house, a dimension, but so this is like another kind of video that you find, it's not necessarily instructional, it's more like a greatest hits that this person decided to upload. So just for comparison, for example, if you look at other software like the Adobe Creative Suite or actually most other video or photo editing software, they seem to cater to a distinctly prosumer or semi-professional mentality, where the ambition is always to surpass or blur or ultimately erase the line between amateur and professional production. And so the tutorial videos that accompany those particular softwares and even affirm these positions tend to be similarly sober or predictable and also task-oriented. Maybe we could say they're by the book and leave almost no room for improvisation or ad-libbing. But SketchUp and its stubborn insistence on ease of use, relatively low hardware requirements, and entry-level community-oriented positioning ends up attracting a messier, more brazenly cavalier crowd to the task of instructional video making. Maybe this is because SketchUp is already sets up a kind of fallacy around user participation and knowledge production, in the sense that it's already, you know, it would be foolish to for somebody to expect that because they could design something in SketchUp, they could take their thing through building processes. So some of the best online tutorials are focused on really specific subject matter or surprisingly narrow objectives, and they usually take us through a bunch of procedures and step-by-step methods towards some kind of end that we probably wouldn't otherwise expect. So if you look at SketchUp tutorials, you can find entire genres of short clips on creating pretty specific architectural elements like hip roofs and spiral staircases. Actually, spiral staircases are quite strange. For whatever reason, people seem to think we can't have enough spiral staircase tutorials. So there's actually like 100 videos on how to make a spiral staircase in SketchUp on YouTube. So what's interesting about this to us is that these extremely specific tutorials begin to call attention to the kind of partitioning of knowledge that these kinds of videos encourage. So this is much different from other methods for teaching and learning software, like following guidebooks or instruction manuals or attending classes or workshops. The video tutorial can be broken down into such small, specific, searchable chunks, at least on YouTube, that mastery appears attainable within just a short series or a few minutes of easily conveyed steps. So from how to trace a floor plan in one video to how to create walls in another and followed by how to finish the roof in another. And each method is probably being conveyed by a different video maker at different points in time and in different parts of the world. This, you can't hear this, but this person is just worth listening to for a second.
Hold it like that so that it says bottom section. We're going to make bottom of the top, so we're going to get rid of the top one. Now I'm going to take curve tool and pull up an exact half circle. It's a little tall, so I might scale it down with the scale tool.
Okay. So Because of this, the series of videos you might watch to learn how to model something like a house, for example, suggest at the same time a depth of understanding and a superficial ease of comprehension that would be otherwise irreconcilable. So the software user then can claim command over complicated and what might be considered advanced sets of knowledge without actually having a firm grasp of any fundamentals, like how to work to scale or what each tool is even called. But what's compelling about all of this for us is that by viewing and close listening and scrutinizing tutorial videos online is the idea that in their kind of on-the-fly, improvisational manner, they're oscillating from performative gestures to documents of an operational task carried out. So there's also, well, at least most of the time, a very tangible sense of anxiety that's produced in how the video makers position themselves in relation to the question of their own status, whether they're what you might call novice or amateur or hobbyist or dilettante or expert. And it's clear that most of these video makers are never quite comfortable with how we might see their position on that spectrum. So most of the time with the videos on YouTube, the topic of credentials, experience, or interest in creating a tutorial is left unaddressed, with only a few exceptions. So we might have to look to other factors to carry the weight of credibility. So which video has the most views, which is the longest in duration, or which is the shortest. Which has the most thumbs up or thumbs down, or what seems to be the most appropriate title, or at least the one with the least amount of misspellings. So all these videos, in a way, seem to make apparent the fairly huge promises and crushing disappointments of professional software tools when they're placed in the hands of amateurs. So if you screen capture and narrate a tutorial video, you actually cast yourself as a star in a do-it-yourself reality TV show, a computational mastery, digital savvy, and millennial age entrepreneur self-assertion. Software like iMovie, Photoshop, SketchUp, and Google Earth seem to make promises for something like an intensely American brand of can-do spirit. The other thing that's interesting is that the tutorial space is a relatively intimate space, at least compared with other forms of instruction. So not just in the sense that we might see the kind of mess of files on the producer's desktop computer or with the unintentional background sounds that the microphone picks up in the video maker's workspace, which is actually usually their bedroom at home, but also in the way that the online tutorial performs almost like a digital confessional. So there's usually a kind of informal admission of what we would call amateur's remorse, right? So we saw one in the first video where Requiem Dissidia, the user, typed into the notepad, "I don't know how you officially do this, I just figured out this technique, so there it is." So the amateurism of the user-made tutorial video is something like an unsteady performance of control, expertise, and mastery. And for us, at least, in thinking about this, these video makers walk a very thin line between sincerity and parody, where they usually produce certain kinds of knowledge, but also a very vague sense of uncertainty. So that sort of larger, expanded version will be published in Perspective, the next issue. That's it. Thanks.
Thank you, Erin. And can we light up this room a little bit to get maybe warmer? So I just have one question to the assembly here. Having seen so many different approaches and concerns, what are the challenges for you as a group of young architects today? And recently in this room we heard lectures by architects and faculty members who have made it big, so to speak. They have their fingers in various products, they have been awarded grand prizes, and most importantly, they have connections. What do you think you have to do to get there, or do you want to get there? Are you ready or not? So, like, I don't know if you have, you already answered a little bit that question, but I'm curious, Erin's case, were you obviously mocking architecture in a serious way here? And your sort of absurd concerns about the average is kind of mind refreshing. So how do you think you want to sort of proceed?
Right. I mean, to be honest, right now we're trying to just not go broke. I think if there's a sort of something we're working on, it's how to financially stabilize our work, because most of the things we're doing, maybe 100% of the things we're doing, we're not getting paid for in any way. Not even like for our time, but also just like materials. And I think if there's a big difference between the people that spoke here, that those other people and maybe us on some level, it's you get paid for building buildings, and there's some weird expectation that if you're right now, or understanding that if you're a young architect that might be asked to do an installation, that there's not going to be funding for your work. And so we have three of projects right now where that's the case, and it doesn't seem like anybody's talking about it, but it seems to be an increasingly large problem or space that we're all working in, that I guess on some level we're trying to make productive as part of some of the projects, but I think, I don't know, it seems like something that we are all kind of dealing with in a way. Stephen, you're building, but I don't know.
Stephen, are you building a house for your parents?
Not that you don't like lose money when you're building.
Or a rich auntie? I mean, that always works.
No. All my older family members passed away a long time ago. But I think that produces a certain anxiety in my case. I mean, my parents died when I was a teenager, and I was kind of self-sufficient after, like, 17-ish. And so I think I, more than maybe other people in my generation, have a need to like form to practice to take on projects that maybe don't seem to have a huge amount of opportunity and potential. And I think it perhaps comes from a kind of lack of having a safety net from a long time ago, but also maybe a conversation that I had with Monica when I started teaching it at Michigan, when she kind of talked to me about the two ways of forming a practice, how in her case with Nader, they kind of took on whatever project they could and kind of powered through it, sort of made a practice out of a lot of really crappy projects and just finding the kind of opportunity that lied in there. With Scott, on the other hand, kind of taking his time and waiting for the right opportunity to strike. And maybe it was my kind of upbringing that led me to choose the former, even though I regret it a lot of times when I do have annoying little things that come up with the kind of projects that you get as a young practitioner. But I would also say finding grant money is probably the biggest challenge, because certainly the three first installations I did were quite expensive, and luckily we were able to, you know, get Al Taubman to chip in a lot of money to pay for them. But when you're not at a school with enormously deep pockets like Michigan happened to have, it is tough finding grant money to do these kinds of things. And in my case, I'm interested in building things that you can go inside of. I mean, I am really interested in space, so there is a kind of scale problem there as well.
You're waiting for Mars?
Or for Turkey?
Yeah, I'm waiting for Turkey more so than Mars. I mean, to me, it's a general problem, so to say, for many architects, this anxiety to build something. I think everybody feels that coming in their career, but I also think that the oeuvre of architectural production is broad, and I mean, financial consideration is one thing, but I think applications of spatial design from a technological angle is what I'm interested in, and I would consider a potential VR simulation also as a form of spatial experience. And I really do believe that in terms of, you know, thinking about representation, there will be a moment very soon where we'll probably download a building to experience it. So in that regard, I kind of find it a little archaic to be so obsessed with the physical nature of architecture. On the other hand, there's a reality of life, obviously, but for me, I just think that it is, obviously, there's a constant hustle one has to do when you're young and you're trying to build a career, and I think that's pretty normal. And I don't think that it is something to complain about other than when you have a deadline and you haven't slept for 3 days. But there's something actually quite exciting about it because you can do whatever you want.
So when you progress from a student where you don't sleep to sleeping a little bit when you first start to work, I sleep very well now, thank you. But I'm at the end of my career, so Julia, so you have it made, no? In ready-to-wear business.
I don't know if I have made it, but I would like to add one thing. I think Greg always told me when I was studying with him that he said, I'm not teaching you what you need to know today or tomorrow. I'm teaching you what you need in 10 years. And so when I was a student at the Angewandte in the first year, it was the year when the Angewandte got the 3D printer. And everyone didn't know how to use that machine or what actually to do with it. And I sort of got really excited about it and printed the hell out of what I could and printed so many models and got really excited about the technology and the opportunities of it. And at one point during my career, when I was with Ross, I actually realized that you can not only print like architectural prototypes, which then stay models, but you can actually use the technology to go real and to actually make products with it. And so I found that really exciting, and I feel I still would like to actually use the technology for a much, much larger scale. So I think that there are certain opportunities with these new technologies. I mean, 3D printing is not a new technology, it exists since 30 years, but I feel that new processes allow you to work with these technologies differently. So I didn't plan to arrive where I am today, like 10 years ago. I just sort of like went with the opportunities which were available and tried to excessively work with them. So, and I think that there's so much more to explore. So I wouldn't say that I'm at the end or so, but I think that there's so much more to bring that research into a much, much larger scale and to work progressively, not only in the fashion industry, but also within architecture, even if it might not allow me at this point to do so.
Well, we always have to be careful what we wish for. So Erin will do her next project on instructions for 3D printing off the internet, and it will be probably as entertaining as it was this time. So I want to just open up the floor, as it is traditional here, that some questions from the audience are asked for, or colleagues here. So otherwise we just go right to dinner. Are there any burning question in this icy room?
Um, The dress that you made, the first dress that was of a relatively stiff material, first, could only that model wear it, or could various people wear it? Was it made specifically for her?
So the dress was not specifically made for her. It's the measurements and dimensions were specifically made for haute couture sizes. So if you're a haute couture model, you would fit into it. So however, what 3D printing is really exciting, and the technique, is that you can actually customize the 3D print to fit you perfectly. So. Yeah, there was a gap where she could actually put her arms down. However, I think that in the way of how Iris wanted the model to walk, that's why she had the arms like this. But I think that the first piece, actually, now it's 4 years ago, was still a time when there wasn't any flexible material available. So. I think this really showcases how different the stiff material is versus flexible 3D printed material.
When do amateurs become professionals? And do each one of you, how do you think of yourselves as professionals, and in what?
Most of these people probably don't think they're amateurs. There's a kind of space that allows them to.
I have to say, I'm a little bit in a state of shock because I don't know why you would invoke the amateur to ridicule them, except to perform a kind of expertise in your ability to reveal their amateurism. So when you said, where is the difference, and you say, I don't know, that's also part of your performance expertise. So I find it coy, and I find that kind, I mean, I'm just feel as though I know you well enough that I can be direct. I find that coyness over the amateur to be the oldest possible form of expertise. So I.
I think it's a form of expertise that isn't. That isn't like. Somehow recognized in the same way as if you're somehow certified a professional, let's say.
I think the tone of your presentation would have been different, and you would have pointed to forms of knowledge that they generated that you wouldn't be able to perform with the expertise that you have.
Yeah.
So you would be asking, what do they know?
Right.
What do they know, and what can we know about them, rather than through a kind of tonal implication, it would be more a performance of what they don't know.
And the intentional knowledge.
Well, I mean, it's not that there aren't things to know. I mean, I actually think that your initial, that the premise is that there are forms of knowledge exchange that happen in these instructional videos,
yeah.
And we might think about what that is, and imagine, I would say, to Guvenc, that the next moment,
that the issue before us is maybe not, or the issue before him may be the virtual building or the 3D printed building, but the issue before you is probably the instructional video on how to make a building.
Yeah.
So I get that. I mean, and that I think is, in, you know, to think of the online
YouTube house as a step, say, beyond the Wiki house and that kind of thing, I think is super interesting. And to understand that out there in that platform, architecture and its instructional modality is going to find a whole range of experts. I mean, I get all of that, but I still think to make it, let's say, politically palatable, mm-hmm. That universe is of interest insofar as it produces a different kind of knowledge.
Yeah.
And I don't feel as though I could walk out of this room with any sense that I learned from you what kind of knowledge could be found there.
Okay.
And I'm sure you either you know it and haven't told us because you're saving, this is an ad for go read the article in Prospecta. I mean, maybe that's cool, but if you don't, you know, that's fine. Maybe, but if it's not, then it's an instructional video that doesn't instruct. And so, you know, I'm sure you know it, but it would be, I mean, I just sort of say this as a friendly amendment, would actually be sort of generous to articulate what, you know, what it is.
What forms of knowledge these amateurs produce?
Yes, because otherwise what we see is the form of knowledge you produce through your ironic take on them.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why I said it's a traditional form of expertise or stepping up or elevating to high, etc. And a different view would be they are, you know, this is a knowledge exchange system. It's an open source knowledge system, which presumably is going to produce a lot of error. But I think the implication would have to be is that it potentially produces new forms of knowledge that is, you know, that we wouldn't have access to otherwise. And it would just be really interesting
out
to know
that
what that
nine,
is.
Out of the 9, it was really black.
It was what?
It was black.
Oh, I didn't mean for
it
to
black
across that way.
A sense of you. It was so not optimistic.
Really?
Well, I didn't say creepy.
It reminded me of Kilgore Trout, Kurt Vonnegut. The character is kind of meandering down the street and encountering signs that he can't decode.
Hmm.
The line it shows must have meant something to someone.
Well,
but the kind of degree in which kind of performance art that's self-descriptive,
uh-huh.
Which I think to me is kind of ingenious indictment of YouTube more than the video itself, or the degree which is kind of technology of the videos. And being that they are instructional and they are verbally describing what they are deductively acting.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know, I found that I agree with the Texas artists at some level, but then I agree solely with them very much, but I also it did take me back to that kind of moment of encountering a world that was highly structured and somehow resulted.
Mm-hmm.
But is this, to me, I mean, it's sort of like, in a way, you know, you want to be registered architect and belong to the AA. It's not a goal, I think, maybe, or is it a goal for everybody here?
I mean,
because when we talk about professionalism, is it
yeah.
something that's understood? At the same time, you know, there are probably more sophisticated videos on YouTube, which you didn't show.
Right, because those aren't the ones we're so interested in. No,
yeah.
I mean, I think...
Isn't the dilemma about what it is to be creative? I mean, I think for me, the deferral is a deferral about where being creative is. I kept waiting for the stud conqueror to come up as the solution for this audience, which is creating something which is a creative form, it's creating an application. I mean, I'd be curious, Erin, you know, where in the spectrum of creativity you locate yourself. You know, whether it's don't want to do the monumental shape, so I'm going to be creative in a modest way, or whether you're saying, I'm just not being creative that way anymore.
I think that's what it is, at least right now. I guess you could say we're being creative by making another tool or some kind of, method or system for other people to participate in. And like, to be honest, what we've been most interested in is just on some level in getting other people to participate in the project to do work for us. So it kind of opens up, so some things are incredibly controlled, but it also sort of opens up the space of production for people that may or may not know how to do particular things. So I guess on some level, we're interested in these particular kinds of videos because of the way that they compartmentalize knowledge and deliver it in a very, in a way that seems to be most digestible today. Like through recording, I guess, processes that you follow, and then you kind of repeat them or play them back in a way. This wasn't meant to be like dark or, I don't know, maybe just because I'm a little sick, but no, we're super interested in this stuff and think it's a really sort of productive space to work within and try and, in some ways turn our own practice into the kind of like instructional video, whether we make instructional videos or not, or like software online that somehow instructs people how to do something, de-skills things, I guess.
Because I mean, I also felt it was dark because I was waiting for the other foot to drop. But I mean, doing some alternative version of being creative for clearly a big group of people that was trying to be creative, and it's an interesting paradox versus just, you know, making something to look, or waiting for somebody to ask you to be creative.
Maybe the thing that's in common with the people making the SketchUp models and what we've heard tonight is that you were all pretty clear about having restricted opportunities, or at least, you know, starting with you, Stephen, where you were very direct about it, and then trying to figure out how to work within that in some way. And I think it's a more so than the last four. There's a way in which you describe, all right, the circumstances that I have at hand, whether it was technology or economy, structured the set of opportunities, or fashion, for 3D printing, structured the opportunities that I could then try to explore. And I wonder, when Mark says, do you want to be a registered member of the AIA, whether that's sort of no longer on the table in your minds for what you're doing, basically these sets of opportunities that you had from 2008 forward have led you in a path that just sets up a different kind of career and set of opportunities that creativity as an open question is almost not available. It's more a set of, you know, all right, now the technology that's here makes it so that I can do certain things and explore certain things, just like the kid who's making the house. And then we're taking it from there, see what we can make out of it. It's not the end state, whatever that guy's doing or what you're doing. And I kind of admire, Stephen, that you were then talking about a house, but you distanced it so greatly from the other things you were doing. I wondered if that was an indication that you saw this sort of early career and potential later career as two different phases of your life.
Yeah. It's interesting. So the when I was kind of talking about the economy, I didn't feel like it was really limiting my options, and that I was desperately wanting to go directly into teaching, and it totally worked out. So I was thrilled by that opportunity. I was more interested in kind of what it was doing in terms of like changing people's reception toward architecture. And in my case, perhaps because I came to architecture from the outside, I was actually more interested than any of my friends in terms of becoming like the kind of architect that we learn about in the media. I took the AREs during thesis. I got registered like within a year after graduation, I was like hell-bent on getting my license because it sort of, I don't know, maybe because I was the outsider, I had a chip on my shoulder. Maybe if I did an undergrad in architecture, I would have been, you know, more interested in sort of looking at the fringes of our discipline, whereas instead I'm kind of standing at the, or I felt like I was standing at the edge of our discipline and looking in. But certainly I think that some of the goals that I articulated in the installation work are goals that probably aren't going to work, they're not going to be taken to that much fruition in a kind of relatively small house. They are things that I hope to work on in public buildings later on. So in a sense, yeah, the installation work is probably charting a course better than the built work, but the built work is helping me hopefully get some practice at doing, the, you know, working within the profession while I'm on my way there. Yeah, I don't really do that.
We talked about this very briefly at some point in the class, but I think for me, there will be a lot of opportunities in a lot of tech companies because everybody's interested in spaces. And if you think about the way that software companies talk about their work, they make a lot of architectural references. And they talk about how construction of the interfaces that they design are based on certain kind of architectural principles. So for me, and I being trained as an architect opens up a lot of opportunities to apply your knowledge in places like architecture firms and as well as advertising firms, software companies, gaming, entertainment. I think all those are valid locations for you to apply your knowledge, but in terms of figuring out what you're going to do after or what you're going to do in the interim, I think that's a really difficult question and depends on really your personal interest to find the right place for yourself. But I mean, I would imagine that more than half of my students are going to be working at architecture firms at least. But I would be very happy to see somebody working in a place like Autodesk or working in a place like, I don't know, Tesla or a Faraday Future or places that are other industries, in other industries, but they will have spatial applications. So, I mean, in terms of licensing, I'm licensed in Turkey. I went to Vienna to work for Greg, and then three of my exams expired. It was just not a priority to be licensed in the US at the moment in my life. They make it incredibly difficult in this country to get licensed for young architects. And it is the generation of people who didn't go through such scrutiny to get their licenses. So who made those decisions. So in that regard, I think leave architecture, but design spaces.